If you don't want to mute it right now, that was
the. I think I'm just gonna
leave it. Okay, fair enough. Fair enough.
And then, I screwed up the last time. I feel really
bad. And then you can just move it over when to show this screen when they come
on. Yeah, and if then I'll ask him if he wants to go ahead and put this on. I think it'll be a better. Okay.
Awesome. And when you're done, just end it, and you'll be good.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. What time are we supposed to start? Okay. I think the show's going a little bit longer. We got the right presenter this time. Oh, you know, I kind of felt bad. That gentleman who presented, he did the first presentation before that one. And 2 days ago, we asked him if he could pull something together. So he did. So, I mean, it was, yeah, I thought so too. Like, I mean, with the time he had, I mean, his first one, but I mean, I just felt bad for him because, you know, he helped us out and helped us out of a tight spot. So. Are you wanting to wear this? Because they said it comes through much better on the recording. If yeah. So we have to do is just when you put it on, just push that green button and you should be good. So you know how to put it on? What'd you think of him? I know, right? So try it, turn it on, let's see if we can hear you.
Testing.
Yeah.
Justine.
Yeah, that's way better. Oh, sure, absolutely. Yeah. They may get up and walk out. I figured you were. No, I thought he was really good, but I wanted to see what he did with that number. Did you notice he changed it when he was talking to us? It was 970171. And then at the very end, he goes, go ahead and put 970101. Write it down. I'm like, because I wrote it, when he held it up, I wrote it down. Yeah. Like, so sure. Devious. I love magicians. Now, do you fly out tonight? Oh, that's right. You're going to, you're staying for 2 weeks. God. I'm flying up to Illinois next Thursday. I'll be up there until the following Monday, till the 11th. I'm gonna go watch my grandbaby. I'm going to run to the bathroom quick, Jeff, okay?
Okay. Well, I guess I had that article from the Irish health system kind of loaded up, and I should connect it to your Wi-Fi. That would work. I'm connected to my cell phone right now. It's just pulling it up. At least we can go to TMPH.
Yeah, and there's no password. So you're going to drive out to your mom's tonight then?
Yeah.
Nice. Over. Over. The sun, where's sunrise? That could be on here.
Sun City West, you know, Sun City West is by Surprise.
Okay. Surprise. It's not Sunrise, it's Surprise. That's where she's at, right?
She's in Sun City West.
Sun City West, okay.
Yeah. It is by Surprise. It's
okay.
It's right in that area.
It's not too far.
No.
It's not too bad.
No. It's really not worried about 303 or
101. Well, if you, I don't know if you want to plan on staying after this, but like if you get out, like before the traffic, you'd probably get there a lot quicker. So.
And I will. I'll be ready to leave. Check that. Start
people go by?
Oh, no, that would.
That whole watch thing, like, that was, I was like, oh, and then the phone thing, I'm like, oh man, I don't even do stuff like that.
Yeah, well, I was sick to that. I was sick that they were so happy. There was no talking to anyone.
Yeah.
Remember how when he said that lady's phone down and pretended like he grabbed it?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know if the husband was still there.
Yeah.
He changed it.
Yeah.
He changed it before he came down. He had already looked at the contact. He'd seen the last four digits of that number.
And he's very good at, like, seeing, like, being very aware and seeing it, you know.
Talents, they're not the talents you think they are.
Right, yeah.
Remind me if I can turn this mic. Yeah.
Okay.
You.
Hi.
We have one guest still.
Okay.
Did they let out in the magic room? Do you know?
I never. I did not.
Oh, yeah. You today. Okay.
Jennifer. You too.
You were. All around here.
Where are you in Arizona? I'm probably the massive oddball out in this whole group.
You're in what?
Mortgages. Come on. She's actually a senior, but I have my bachelor's and part of my master's in healthcare. So,
oh, nice.
Yes, for quite some time, but I've been doing various customer service for 16 years in various industries. So I just kind of talked customer service for a while. And
so
she was on Mac and she was part of the 11. She was doing people help. So
what's your mom's name?
Sheila.
I was trying to remember if I knew her, but this doesn't ring a bell.
No, she was on the same time as the was.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, didn't really. And I was like, okay, I'll have some in her. But no, it's, I was trying to see about possibly going in, but I was more on the tech side versus the healthcare side, but more information management versus actual tech technology programming. Programmers and developers. My wife brings at home, he's a data developer for his company, and he's like talking all these things. And I'm like,
whoa!
Wow.
days. Who else?
Right. No, but I mean, if you have the ability to get it, even through connections or any like. That's crazy. Cool, even if they have the infrastructure already set up and we just implemented the COVID data into it already. Yeah, they're huge. No, but this has been cool. I've done most of the tech classes already. So, like, there's some of the other side that's like, oh, I think I'm cool now. And then I'm like, they're like, oh, if I need a presentation, you can email. So, like, ah, email. I was like, who knows in the tech? Because I haven't been in my health degrees. I finished my last thing. I'm like, go hear about all the tech. But the last major stuff that I actually got studying with was they were still working on getting like a central.
There's still not out yet. All the rooms are empty, so we're good.
They were still working on trying to figure out like a hub, like a Bravo medical group, still trying to set up like a hub so that all of the Bravo locations. Could get any of their patient information from any other location. I'm like, yeah, that would be a pretty smart idea. You could get it set up. But I mean, that was the last, but now it's part of my bachelor's program.
I don't know.
It's
good.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just to watch it continue to develop. It's crazy. I mean, from where we were, where we are, to the fact that we're even talking AI in the first place. Like, there's so much potential that we can still move with. But at the same time, it makes you kind of wonder, like, if we're going to go into the AI factor, there's only so much because you still have that individual personal experience that you can't program into. Even from,
So what was the last number? What was that number? What was the closing thing with that number? 970171.
That was what it was originally. Turned out to be 721025.
720. Was there anything else in the envelope?
No, he just originally did not fold it all
the way. Oh.
Same amount of duct tape, which is the same cards that were left on the table on the prior card trip. It also happened to be the number.
Oh my God. Wow. How does that work?
Is good.
If you're just a few more minutes, I'm sure people are like running to the
bathroom. I was pretty sure there was no real hacker guy on the phone. I figured he was just changing the numbers and stuff. I mean, how he did it so quickly and so well, but I didn't think there was no one taking control of our phones. He didn't really change the time on our phones, did he?
No.
No, he just convinced us he did.
Right.
I was 100% convinced that
it was a hacker. Well, the other thing was still up there.
Oh yeah, sure. Yeah.
Lots of phones that do get hacked.
Oh yeah, yeah. Yeah, you don't want to carry a phone to DEF CON. I've never gone to DEF CON, but that's pretty well known that you don't want to bring. You better know what you're doing if you're going to bring an electronic device into DEF CON, whether it's a phone or a laptop or anything. They're all set up trying to hack it. Yeah, those people are top of their game. Though they're the best. Including probably people from NSA are there, which they're all on top of their game, whatever their game is. I stand up, feel like I'm going to talk, but
you're just going to talk.
Well, I
yeah.
That's what you want.
Yeah. This is going to throw everybody's schedule off.
Yeah.
But it sounds like it was worth it. Oh, I should have seen the end of that. Was it good?
Yeah.
I suppose I could go home and get started and they can just come in.
Yeah, I think you should.
Okay, I'm gonna close the door quick.
If we send one online, we are soon to starting late. The semantics room is good.
All right, well, he had to leave to go to catch a plane. So Montgomery is the sponsor, his company sponsors this track, and he is with ServiceNow, thank you. You should come here and do this now. So this afternoon, we have Jeff Bell with us. Jeff Bell is a CISO in advisory services. He has 34 years in information technology with 13 in cybersecurity. He holds a bachelor's in physiology, math, and computer science with Northern Michigan University. And he carries certs in CISSP, GSLC, and CPHMS. And from there, I'm going to turn it over to Jeff and let him talk about cybersecurity.
Thanks for coming to the session. Yeah, we're going to focus in on ransomware today, and we're all, I'm sure, well aware that ransomware has been a very high impact on healthcare organizations. It seems like attacks are continuing to grow in frequency and in sophistication and severity, impacting organizations. This morning, I was kind of reading and thinking about this, and I came across an article I'm going to take a few minutes to share. Does everyone remember that in May, the Irish National Health System was attacked by Conti ransomware, and it had a devastating impact. The whole national health system was basically down. And there's an interesting article published just, that occurred, like I said, it was May 14th. And just at the beginning of September, the BBC did this interview with a patient who was impacted at the time, as well as some of the radiology people. And I'm going to skim around the article and not read the whole thing to you, but I think it gives some good insight into how patients are affected by a ransomware attack and how the clinicians struggle to continue to operate. So give me a sec to pull this up. So the first time Donna heard about a massive cyber attack on Ireland's health system, it was on the morning news. The 36-year-old mother of two was waiting for her radiation treatment that afternoon for sarcoma, a rare and aggressive form of brain cancer. I thought this was an awful situation for the Irish health system to be in, she says. After that, I got a call at lunchtime and was told that my radiation wouldn't be going ahead because of the cyber attack. I didn't realize the severity, how invasive and how horrific this attack was. On May 14th, when the attack occurred, Ms. Cullen was nearing the final stages of her treatment, having been diagnosed September 2020. For the space of my time, when my radiation was paused, there was a huge worry from the calls. The attack in May was unprecedented in the history of the Irish state, affecting almost every part of its health system, already worn down by more than a year of fighting COVID. Scrambling to deal with the situation, so listen to this, staff reverted to a paper system and the number of appointments in some areas dropped by 80% in the days after the attack. For Ms. Cullen, her radiation treatment looked set to be postponed as staff were not able to enter the correct coordinates used for with the machine for her treatment. She says it was only because St. Luke's Radiology Oncology Center at Dublin's St. James Hospital had been able to separate its machinery from the wider systems, and the consultants had spent the entire weekend rewriting coordinates that it was able to resume without a major delay. So they pulled that radiology treatment machine off the network to protect it and were able to keep it functioning, but without access to the, you know, beer can or whatever tool was calculating the equipment settings. But that period caused great worry for Ms. Cullen. I know the severity of sarcoma. I know how fast sarcoma can grow. She says they don't do stages of sarcoma. You either have sarcoma or it has spread. And if it has spread, it is terminal. So for me, it was the worry if there was even a small chance of a crumb of this cancer left in my head, that it would just start to multiply. My radiation plan would need to be completely revised. Just going to skim down on a few more things. At this time, HSC, that's what they call the Irish Health System, has more than 95% of all servers and devices restored. So it's been 4 months, right? The ransom amount was $20 million. If you remember what happened, the people running the ransom kind of had mercy, if you want to say that. They decided to relent, and they gave them the decryption key without paying the ransom. But they said, you still have to pay the ransom, and we stole your data, and we're going to release your data if you don't pay it. So, but they said, we're going to, you know, we realize we've really botched up a lot of people's lives. So they gave them the key. But so even so, 4 months later, they're not fully functional yet, right? A couple more points, and then we'll get into my talk. Of the areas recovering from the cyber attack, radiology is among the worst affected, in part due to its reliance on computers. While services have been restored to 90% capacity, issues persist. Services happen in a slower fashion. Each of the elements involved in generating these images are subject to crashes and outages, which happen sporadically. Dr. Kavanaugh says, which means that patient throughput is slower than usual. The provision of on-call services has been particularly hazardous. He says an on-call radiologist looking at something which could be a clinical emergency would ordinarily be able to view a scan on their home, from their home. However, while that technology has been restored for many, some radiologists are having to go through the process of driving into the hospital numerous times over the course of a weekend to provide on-call cover. So can you imagine, the medical staff trying to cope with this? The IT staff are probably working, 16 hours a day or whatever for the past months. It's a devastating attack.
Yeah. There you go. And now the arrow should work.
Okay. So what we're going to talk about today is I'll spend a couple more minutes on kind of the ransomware threats and risk topic, and then I'm going to turn to talking about some best practices, some recommended practices to reduce the risk of ransomware. I do believe that, if IT and security teams, do the right things and do them well, and are able to maybe increase their investment depending on what level of teams they have at this time, that they can bring this risk down to a manageable level. HIPAA uses the term, risk never goes to zero, but you want your risk to be reasonable and appropriate. So you've got to bring it down to where you can manage it. So we'll talk about those both topics there. Here's a slide from the Ransomware Task Force. This is a team that's been together of experts from software industry and various organizations, including government and academic institutions, trying to figure out, not necessarily at our level as practitioners, but their level, what they can do to reduce the risk of ransomware. So they issued this report in May. And notice, I thought this slide was quite good, that the average downtime for ransomware attacks is 21 days, 3 weeks. That's average. So some people do better, some people do worse. So I hesitate to tell the hospitals I work with that, if you get hit by ransomware, that's the average. I have told them that, but it's a devastating statement. I mean, if you've worked with that, I don't know what I didn't get a chance to ask you guys what you do, but most organizations are thinking about what is our recovery time objective, right? If you're developing a disaster recovery plan, you're asking yourself, what's your recovery time objective? And most healthcare organizations, they want a 4-hour recovery time objective for critical systems, for the most critical systems in the EHR, or maybe 24 hours. Maybe we'll say we can go 24 hours. No one's going to say they can go 3 weeks. And the average ransom payment for those who pay the ransom was $300,000. I'm going to skip some stuff. I know we went a little long on the magic show, and so we'll try to make up a little time, but I don't want to rush in. If you guys do want to ask a question or interject a comment, I'm good with that. You don't have to wait till the end. A few facts about ransomware, and this is coming. I got my source at the bottom there, a Covware report from the first quarter of this year, that 77% of ransomware attacks during that time period they were looking at included exfiltration of data. So that's been new the last couple of years, where they're not just encrypting your data and saying you're going to have to pay us to get the decryption key. They're also stealing the data and saying, even if you don't pay us to decrypt your data and you're going to recover it from backups, if you don't pay us, we're going to release the data. That's kind of what they did at the Ireland health system, isn't it? Now, this next one is worth thinking about. Nearly half of ransomware attacks begin with cyber criminals compromising RDP. Does everyone know RDP? Are you IT people at all? Do you know what RDP is? You know, it's a particular Microsoft service. Thanks. RDP is a Microsoft service that lets you remote into another computer, and IT administrators use it a lot to work on systems. But in my opinion, you know, as an IT and a cybersecurity person, you should never have RDP sitting on the internet. It should always be behind the VPN, right? You got to log into that VPN if you want to get to RDP. So why the heck all these people have RDP sitting out on the internet? It's where it can be attacked through stolen credentials or exploiting unpatched vulnerabilities, because Microsoft has had some big vulnerabilities. So this is a quick win. You know, if you're in that role where you're, you know, in IT, you're in cybersecurity at a hospital, go back and scan your external network and see if you have RDP exposed. And if you do, get it off there. There's no reason for that. No one needs that. So right there, you've cut half of your initial compromise points. I'm not saying the attackers will give up and say, oh, they didn't have RDP, I'll quit. But at least you've stopped them from an easy first step into your network. Now, the second most common attack vector is email phishing. So there's no easy solution to email phishing, right? We all need to work on it. We're going to talk about some suggestions, but email phishing is a tough vulnerability. The FBI released this flash report in May talking about Conti. I won't read all this, but they were so concerned. So this was happening. They put this out, a few days after that Ireland attack, and alerting us that US healthcare organizations and first responder organizations were being hit by Conti. And telling everyone to be on high alert for it. Okay, so we're going to move now into talking about recommendations, practices to reduce our risk. As I thought about this presentation, I was going to use the term defense in depth. If people heard of that term, you know that term. It's kind of an old cybersecurity term. And I said, no, that's too old. It's not that in-depth is wrong. The idea of in-depth, right, is that there's no single safeguard. No single step of protection that alone is a silver bullet, but by layered, multiple steps, you can reduce that risk. So we used to talk about defense in depth, but that defense is not the right strategy anymore. It takes more than defense. In other words, you want to defend, you want to protect, you want to prevent, but you want to do more than that. And the NIST cybersecurity framework came out in 2014, updated a little bit in 2018. And they talk about these five security functions that we need to have a comprehensive cybersecurity program. So they have protect there, so that's like defense, but they say you also need to be able to detect, respond, and recover. So the idea is that no matter how good your defense is, you're still gonna get compromised. There's so many attacks today, and they're so sophisticated that you can never put enough defense in to see your risk of being compromised going near zero. So instead, you've got to say, I anticipate we will be compromised. We're going to put lots of protection in place. We're going to try to all we can to prevent compromise, but we're not going to stop there. We're also going to invest in monitoring services and incident response services. Disaster recovery services. Make sense? So the first of six things I want to talk about in terms of practices to reduce your risk is vulnerability management. It's like, this is the most basic, most important step. One of the most important steps in cybersecurity, right? To take those servers and workstations and all your IT systems, even your medical devices, right? And reduce those vulnerabilities, especially those that are deemed critical and high. I list kind of the basic steps of vulnerability management. You scan your network, you scan your systems with software that detects vulnerabilities and identifies them. There's a number of great tools for that. When I first started implementing this at a company I was working for, we started doing scanning. I said, all right, finally scanning. And the person who worked for me was emailing the scan to the IT team. And I said, so how's the IT team doing? Are they fixing those vulnerabilities? No, the email was going to the IT team. That's where it stayed. They did nothing with it. So you can't stop there, right? It's my fault, right, for not implementing a process around the technology. So what you have to do, and usually security does this, is they review results, they prioritize, they say what are our biggest risks here, the ones that are most critical, the biggest impact systems. They do some research, how are we going to mitigate? Sometimes there's more than one way to fix a vulnerability. And then usually security is opening a ticket for IT saying, fix these vulnerabilities. And then metrics. Yeah, I can remember if I had put metrics on here or not. But this is so important that, you know, if there's anything in security that you put a report around, you make it visible, you get the CIO to look at it, you get the security official to look at it, you get their boss to look at it. It's vulnerabilities, you know, do some kind of metrics around it so that people can see, are we doing a good job? I don't know, a lot of market organizations aren't, you know, they're still very vulnerable. You see it on some of these slides. Like, here's a vulnerability called Eternal Blue. This was a vulnerability discovered in 2017. It's been patched. Hackers are still using it. They find it on the network, so when they attack you, they find that vulnerability and they use it to attack you. It shouldn't be there anymore. There's no excuse for it. So patching is critical. I mean, patching is part of it, that you can get to a point where you are, you know, we all know when Microsoft puts their patches out, Patch Tuesday, you want to try to close the gap between the time that Microsoft releases their patches and your systems are all patched. You'd like to get that down to days, or at the most, in my opinion, a week, that those patches are fully deployed. And so really working on the process as well as your tools to do patch management is key. But not all vulnerabilities are fixed with a patch. You know, some require configuration changes. And those are the harder ones. So invest in staff and technology and process to really improve vulnerability management, and you'll go a long way then in reducing your risk of being a victim of ransomware. I won't say, in the case of ransomware, I won't say that if you have no vulnerabilities, you won't be compromised, because they still may be able to get in with some of the next things we're going to talk about. They still may be able to get on your systems, run a PowerShell script or run Conti and ransom you. But in most cases, they are finding vulnerabilities and using them in their attack.
So, John, is Conti a script that
infiltrates you? Conti is more than a script. It's a piece of software.
Okay.
Yeah. And you can, anyone that wants to get into crime and, you know, destroying organizations, they can go get Conti off the dark web and learn to use it and go into business.
Wow.
Yeah. This is a list put out by CISA of the top most targeted vulnerabilities in 2020. In other words, these are the top vulnerabilities that were used by attackers and the attacked organizations in 2020. Notice there's a Citrix vulnerability, a Pulse vulnerability, F5, lots of Microsoft vulnerabilities. So you don't want those vulnerabilities on your network, right? Because you know those are being looked for by attackers and they're exploiting them. Now we're moving to a different topic, identity and access management. So I kind of prioritize these, I think vulnerability management, I think identity and access management, these are two areas that if you can make the kind of improvements we're talking about, you'll go a long way to reducing your risk. Now compromised credentials, pretty much every cybersecurity attack involves compromised credentials other than a denial of service attack. They can be done without. So if you can prevent compromised credentials, you've accomplished a great deal. And the number one way to prevent compromising credentials is? Multi-factor authentication. Thank you. So implementing two-factor authentication is like, if you haven't done it in your organization, don't take a vacation, go back to your organization and do it like now. And it'll make a huge difference. And you start with implementing it for all your remote access, right? Including, any VPNs, any webmail. If you have cloud-based systems, Office 365, implement it there. And you will greatly reduce your risk by implementing that. And don't miss anything. Whatever you miss, that's going to be a problem. But don't stop. And here, by the way, I'm giving a lot of this from this is Ransomware Guide, and it's from CISA and MSISAC. This is a great resource. I've got a slide at the end that has links to this. And a lot of what I'm saying is their recommendations on what to do. And specifically, this slide is all about their recommendations. So don't stop with your remote access. Your next step then, because any attack, the attacker wants to get a hold of privileged credentials. Just because they sent a phishing email to an accounts payable clerk who fell for it. And so now they've got control of her PC, his or her PC, and have their credentials. They can operate as that person. They can send email on their PC. That's not what they want. They want the IT domain admin. And so that's one of their next steps that they're gonna go after. So if you can protect those domain admin credentials and get your IT staff better protected using two-factor authentication. Another good thing to do with the IT staff, and hopefully most organizations are doing it, but give those folks two sets of credentials, the domain admin level credentials, and then more of a normal user level credential. And they should never open email, browse the internet with the domain admin credentials. Because if you open a phishing email and you've got domain admin credentials, it's all over. They now are on your network with domain admin credentials. They don't have to do anything else. So you want to, at all costs, prevent that from happening. So we're going to talk in a minute about the MITRE attack framework. How many of you are familiar with the MITRE attack framework? Anybody? Okay. Well, we'll show it to you in a sec and explain a little bit about it. It's kind of a big topic, but we'll make it a little one. Here in that framework, it's an analysis of actual attacks and the tactics and procedures actually used by attackers. And here is a list of all the different ways that attackers compromise credentials. So it's not just one or two things they do. They have a whole slate of methods that they can use to compromise your credentials. Third topic, we're still in the realm of defense, and that would be email protection. So again, we're referring to the Ransomware Guide. Their recommendations are that you give training to people on how to recognize phishing emails. All your organizations are probably doing this, but stop and think about it, make sure they are. Train people on how to get a phishing email, something they think is a phishing email, how to report it to the security department, right? if you give them the phishing simulations, so you're sending an email to them, hopefully they won't click on it. If they do click on it, you're giving them some immediate training. You're telling them, hey, you shouldn't have clicked that. You should have seen this. You should have recognized this. And we're going to test you again in the next 2 weeks, right, to see if you've learned. Lots of other things you can do. You can, you know, you implement an email gateway. I mean, everyone does that, but it's worth, this is so important. It's worth researching what ones are best and really putting in one of the best ones. You want to block malicious and suspicious IP addresses at the firewall. And then these next two are kind of, people resist them because they are hard. They are, the first one here makes an impact on people's lives, but attacks are occurring, ransomware attacks, where you're getting an email of a Word document or Excel document, and there's a malicious macro in it. So the recommendation is to disable macros, at least from Word documents coming in through email and Excel documents, because what that macro will do is download malware. If you click and open that Word document, you're going to download malware. Now your antivirus may block it, your firewall may block it, but it's going to try to download malware. If it's successful, you could be in big trouble. And then there's one other thing I put on here. I won't say too much about it. It would be your messaging engineers that would implement something called DMARC, SPF, and DKIM. And those are settings that they have to put in your root email server to kind of prevent spoofing of email. If you've set that up for your domain, it makes it harder for attackers to impersonate you with email. All right, we're going to move on from defensive things and talk about monitoring and incident response. So the goal with monitoring is to detect malicious events, right? Detect security events. Detect, for example, that someone received a phishing email and clicked on it and did something they shouldn't. And one way you detect it is to train your users to report such things, right? My mom, I'm gonna go see her shortly. I'm from Michigan. She lives in Sun City West. She's 84. And she got an email from that said it was from Amazon the other day. And it said, hey, I got your order. Thanks for your order of $800, and it's on its way. If you have any questions, call us at this button. In big red letters, they have an 800 number. So she fell for it. She called them. What? I didn't order anything. And they said, "Oh, I'm sorry. We can fix this. Don't worry. Just we need your credit card number, and we need your bank account, and also we need to remote into your laptop." And she gave them all that. She did it all. And thankfully, after it was all done and she'd finished, she said, what have I done? So thankfully she realized she had really goofed up. And she called her bank and her bank said, bring your credit card. Get in here right now. They closed her account, closed her credit card. And it messed up her life. She had all these automatic payments. She had to contact all her. But thankfully, she had no theft of any money out of her accounts. But I just share that example. I mean, it's a personal example. But the same sort of thing, right, happens on your networks where someone clicks that email and gets tricked into putting their ID and password into a fake website, right? And now the bad guys have that person's ID and password. And they go, oh crap, what have I done? And hopefully you train them to report it. Don't be ashamed. We all make mistakes. I've fallen through these things. So report it. There's a lot we can say about monitoring incident response. We got to keep it kind of high level here. Let's take a look though at that
MITRE ATT&CK framework. I'm sorry, it's a little scrambled here, but across the top of the screen, you have, and I've blown some of this up with bigger fonts, so hopefully you can read it. There are 14 tactics that occur in most attacks, and this isn't just ransomware attacks, but attacks of various sorts. Let's just look at a few of them. The third tactic is to gain initial access. And they have a list then of techniques that are used by attackers to gain that initial access into your network. So one of them is phishing emails. We've been talking about that, right? Obviously, that's one way they get in. They send you a phishing email, they trick you into disclosing your credentials, or they trick you into opening a Word document with a macro that downloads malware. And there's various other things they can do. Even the other big one about external remote service, that's an RDP thing we talked about at the beginning, that would be one example of that. So they gain initial access. Now, if you're monitoring, the hope is that you detect it. So, you know, you've already failed at preventing the attack, but they've only done step three of a 14-step attack. So if you can detect it at step three, detect it before they collect data on your systems and exfiltrate it and execute an encryption of your network, not too much harm is done. It doesn't happen in a second. You know, it may happen in hours, you know, that they go from step three to step 14, or it may take days. You know, they may spend some time on your network. So you have some time to figure out that something's going on and to do some research and to respond and stop them from doing the harm that they're capable of doing. So that's the MITRE ATT&CK framework. That's the 2-minute description of it. This is another page from the MITRE ATT&CK framework. You can read that. Conti, we've been talking about the Conti ransomware. It's one of the big ones that's actively being used right now. And so if you search for software under the MITRE ATT&CK framework, you get this whole big description of the capabilities of Conti, what it does, how it does it. So that can help you, right? If you know, if you get a ransom message, which we're going to look at next, saying, hey, you've just been encrypted by Conti, we can go here and learn about Conti and help guide you in your response. So here's an actual ransomware message. I think this might be the message that the Irish Health Services received. I'll read just a little bit of it. All of your files are currently encrypted by Conti. As you know, if you don't, just Google it. All of the data that has been encrypted by our software cannot be recovered by any means without contacting our team directly. Now, these are criminals, not necessarily honest, right? They're skin, it's the whole big con job. There are other ways to recover, but your best option might be to contact them. So I won't read the rest, but basically they warn you. At the bottom, it says you should be aware, just in case, if you try to ignore us, we've downloaded the path of your internal data and are ready to publish it out on our news website. If you do not respond, so it'll be better for both sides if you contact us as soon as possible. So if you get this message on your computer and computers across your system, it's a very bad day. And that week, that month, that year.
Almost crazy how there's kind of mice in their message to you, like.
They take pride in being, you know, professional. They want to give good customer service to their victims. Yeah. They do. You can call them, you can talk to them. Although there are companies, and one is, I've had some things from Coldware. That's kind of their specialty, is if you contact them and contract with them, they will contact the ransomware company, and they're experienced at negotiating.
Who's contacting? How does this work? Like, are they checking with each other, or they're making us back and forth, or it's like a call?
They're given a website here, and they in
this case and they want you to use Tor. So yeah, it would be chat. You'd be chatting with them. I've seen the chats with them. I don't know if they ever communicate by phone call. They may probably be you know, some more secure type of messaging.
Yeah.
Same chat or something. But that's what I skipped over that part, but where it says Tor version, they're telling you to contact them through Tor.
There's nothing you can do. There's no way, like, where they are. We can just, like, from the mindset that you, some random phone number calls you, like, in the movies, then we see, like, you can't
go back. No, they, well, that's why they're using Tor. Tor really covers your tracks. That's the whole point of Tor. It's a fancy VPN that hides, so it makes it hard for it. That's why Tor is used on the dark web for criminal activity. But definitely the FBI and Secret Service and the NSA all are involved in trying to identify ransomware gangs, and they do sometimes. They can, now Microsoft works at it as well with the FBI. And if they can succeed, if they can figure out even just what servers are being used, they'll shut them down. They're actively going after these people. And one decision, if you're ever hit by ransomware, one of your decisions is, are we going to involve the FBI? Are we going to contact law enforcement? And it's my recommendation is that you do, because they're the only ones that can prosecute these people, you know, and actually try to take them down and arrest them and all that.
But they're in a country that has an extradition policy.
Yeah. A lot of them are in Russia. A lot of them are
Oh, yeah. I was going to ask that are the majority of the checks coming from the United States or outside?
I don't have percentages, but yeah, you're right. A lot of them are coming from Russia, dark side, Europe, Asia. Yeah. Yeah, China has been behind
Chinese military.
So you hear these names, they're named, these organizations that figure out who they are, these security firms will name, you know, you've heard them called like Panda Bear and things like that. If they have bear in them, that's a Russian. If they have Panda in them, I think that's a Chinese hacker group. It's just naming conventions that we're discovers and uses. CrowdStrike, I think it is, they name them differently. They call them spiders.
So if a hospital in the U.S. is affected,
would the government employees be able to actually help them? The FBI isn't going to restore your servers or do those sorts of things, but what they will do is help you gather evidence so they can prosecute. So it's worth involving them. But what you we'll talk about it in a minute. It makes a lot of sense to have a relationship with an incident response firm that specializes in this ransomware response that can really shortcut getting your systems recovered, getting back to business, as opposed to, I mean, you're tempted to go it alone because, hey, you have these great IT, these great security people, and you think, hey, they can do it, but they've never done this before, and it's not an easy thing to do. But if you can turn 3 weeks into 2 weeks and pay some firm whatever you have to pay them, it's probably well worth it. It's my opinion.
Do you think that most of the ransomware attacks are paid out?
I don't know the percentage. Okay. The FBI, law enforcement, they all say don't pay the ransom.
Uh-huh.
The cybersecurity professionals, it's about 50-50. Half will say, pay the ransom, it's a small price compared to the data, the financial impact of the harm that's being done to your organization. Get that decryption key, but you still don't want to just depend on the criminal organization to guide you in getting back into operation. You want to bring in some outside people who are working for you, not against you.
So what's the ransomware? And even if you have the decryption key, do they have permanent access to that server?
the criminal organization. Yeah. Well, that's one of your objectives, and it's really, that's part of what we're talking about right now is incident response, right? Part of incident response is two key steps in incident response plan are to contain the attack. So you find out what the attackers have done, you figure out what servers they've compromised, you figure out what accounts they have compromised, you change passwords, you rebuild those servers. If you're gonna prosecute them, you do take forensic images first of the server so you have the evidence that you can use for your prosecution. And then, so I said contain, the next step is to eradicate, you know, make sure that before you can recover, before you dare recover, you've got to make sure that the attackers aren't still on your network, because they'll just do it all over again, you know, especially if you pay them. You know, they'll be delighted to, a week later, do it all over again and double the price. So that is what makes, that's why the 3 weeks, really. And we're going to talk in a minute about, I think we're coming to it next, yeah. So the last two topics here are backup and recovery, and then we'll talk about disaster recovery and business continuity. And what makes ransomware attacks, you know, usually part of it, you can look at them as a disaster, and you say, well, just implement your disaster recovery plan. You know, you've made your backups, just recover your systems. But your disaster recovery plan means you're recovering your systems either at an alternate data center or recovering them in place. But before you dare do that, as we just said, you've got to get bad guys off your network. So you're spending a couple of weeks figuring out what the heck happened, how they got in, what they did, you know, did they put any backdoors on their network? How are you going to make sure they don't get back in? And the disaster recovery plan is on hold until you do that. So you're spending a couple of weeks, however long it takes you, to be confident, for everyone to nod their head and say, yeah, we understand how they got on here. It's not going to happen again. We fixed it. You know, if there was a vulnerability they used, if there was some weak passwords they used, whatever, it's not going to happen again. Now do your disaster recovery. So there's some tough decisions to be made along those lines. One of the bits of advice, I won't spend too much time on this last stuff, I know we're over time, but the advice again from the ransomware guide is maintain offline backups. These folks are good and they try to destroy your backups. They know if you can just go to your backups and recover, you're not going to pay the ransom. So they try to actually destroy your backups. Or if you're doing replication, they destroy the replicated data. You know, if you're doing SAN-to-SAN replication, which is pretty common today. So the recommendation is find a way to actually create air gap. Sometimes they call it air gap backups or offline backups. And we used to do that. You know, we used to back up to tape, and we'd rotate tapes off to Iron Mountain or some offsite storage. I don't know if too many people do that anymore. That's really what you're going back to, something like that, to create offline backups. But that way, they can't be destroyed, right? They're not so easily. They have to be physically get their hands on those tapes to destroy them, or CDs or whatever media you're using. There's a lot else in here. I guess I'll skip over this. And then on to disaster recovery and business continuity. Everyone knows what those terms mean, right? Disaster recovery is recovering your IT systems. Business continuity is dealing with how the organization operates without your IT systems, how they continue to function. The story we read with the Irish health system really gave us some insight into the difficulties with doing that. A lot of organizations, I think, do have some kind of an offline backup, right, that they're writing out their EMR data to workstations. I mean, if those can be destroyed, they will. You know, if they're on your network, they'll be destroyed. But So it's important to test, of course, your disaster recovery business continuity plans. This is added incentive to really test thoroughly, make sure your disaster recovery plan really works, time it so you know how long, you know, best case, once you complete the incident response plan, how long before you get the systems back up. I've seen health systems that have gotten so good at disaster recovery that they have their two data centers and they just flip back and forth every quarter. You know, they just say, okay, fail over to the, you know, the south data center. Okay, next quarter, fail over to the north data center. And they just run constantly. They can run equally well out of either data center.
So are they replicas of each other?
Yeah. Yeah, just constantly, the data's always the same on both of them. They're always replicating, or, you know, might be a bit off or something, but not much. So, we're down to pretty much my last slide. Obviously, this is a big deal. You know, this is high impact to our organization. So I think it makes sense, and most organizations have probably already done this. But you know, if not, if your board, your executives, they all know about this. They're all very worried about it, and if you as you know, if you're an IT executive or a security executive or a security leader, you know, go to them and be honest and say, look, we're at risk. You know, don't give them the unvarnished truth and give them some opinions and some recommendations. What can we do to be better prepared to lower our risk? Just a few ideas here for things we've talked about. Maybe you say we need to find an incident response firm and develop a retained relationship with them so that they'll make us a priority. And if you do that, you know, you're paying them some money every year, but they'll usually give you some service for that. Even if you don't have an incident, they'll come and run a drill or help you work on your preparedness. So it's not money you're just wasting if nothing happens. And you'll be very glad you did it if something happens. Maybe you need better backup and recovery tools. Maybe you need a backup tool that will allow you to make those offline backups. Maybe your vulnerability management isn't going well because your tools aren't the best. So maybe you want to improve vulnerability management or patch management tools. Running the penetration test is a great idea. You can tell the pen testers, hey, I'm worried about ransomware. Can you guys use the same techniques that the ransomware people do? And let's see how we do, see if we detect, see if we stop you, see if you can break in. And a pen tester would be happy to do that. And of course, expand the deployment of multi-factor authentication. I wrote down a few other things in my notes that I'm going to just not say too much about, but I just want to, because when I think about what we've talked about, and I think about, like as I say here at the top, the primary source, a primary source for this presentation is the CISA MSISAC ransomware guide. And you can see the link to it here, CISA.gov/ransomware. If you just go to that, you'll see the ransomware guide. But I've probably covered 40% of that guide. And so it's probably a 15-page document of all kinds of recommendations. And there's some important ones I didn't really think we could have time to talk about all of them. So your IT organization, your security organization could do like a gap analysis through this guide and look at each of their recommendations and think about which ones you haven't done and whether you should do them. Just do a gap analysis. I'll mention a couple of other things here. Network segmentation is another one of the recommendations, so that if they get on one part of your network, they can't so easily traverse over to another part. We didn't talk about third-party risk, supply chain risk. That's a big one. You know, if you've got other organizations that are providing services to your hospital that can get into your network, and if their security is not good, and they become a backdoor into your network, and people are getting hit that way. I'll just stop with that.
Thank you so much for that. So I read an article a year ago that most attacks in the US have been on third party companies, like labs or other
companies
that
interact with the system.
Is that true?
I don't know about most, but definitely.
They're usually more vulnerable because they don't have as much of a secure IT security team.
Could be, and it should, right? It should, but yes, definitely there's plenty of examples that where we find third parties, IT firms, support firms, you know, like maybe GE, yes, and GE systems, so they're logged into your network to support the GE systems, or Philips, or Cerner, or Epic. All of those are potential risks. And I think the Cerners and Epics do a, fairly good job with their IT. I know a little bit about some of the work that some work with them. But
it's a big argument against data sharing and how other companies trying to standpoint.
Yeah.
It seems all that data gets leaked. But like the VA system, to my knowledge, and that's a very large health system. So when people say that, segmented data structure, storage is better rather than like having a single unified EMR. Is that a false statement? When people say that your privacy is more at risk because the government, the government's going to have your data or whatever.
I can't deny that it's one strategy to protect data is to separate it. But there's a lot of downsides to doing that too. There's a lot of advantages to storing it in one place. So I don't think I wouldn't want to say that that's something we should all go do, and separate your database into multiple pieces and scatter it around. I just think that the negatives of doing that probably outweigh the benefits.
So if you could choose one over the other.
Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, I wouldn't recommend separating pieces of the database.
But segmenting your network.
Yeah, segmenting the network is a different story.
What I meant is having all these different MRs in the country as opposed to that big ideal of everyone being on the same page.
Yeah. We saw the examples maybe 5 or 6 years ago where all of a sudden the Blue Cross and the other group, most many of the Blue Crosses were attacked. That was attributed to China. China stole all that data. They also stole the HR system or something from the federal government employee databases. And so China at that point probably had data on 2/3 of our citizens. This was what they're going to do with that data. They're not going to do identity theft. They had purposes stealing that data. I don't think it's identity theft.
So, but do you think so? Where an insurance company like that, you think it's better to have multiple systems or just have the one system? Because it seems like there's a vulnerability with having one system cover many, many people versus multiple systems covering multiple people.
Yeah, like I say, I don't think if I'm the IT person, that I'm not going to make that recommendation. I just think the advantages are too great. Instead, focus on securing that single database. Yeah. Okay.
I work in a community health center where it's self-hosted versus the cloud. Now, IT tells us that one of the advantages is that it's safer. But is that really true? Because like all the big healthcare centers are all in the cloud. It's always so difficult because they tell you and it's so hard to fight back.
I do think in some senses that the cloud-based systems can be better. I think Amazon, Microsoft Azure,
their resources to secure their environment is off the charts. But you have to understand what they will do. You know, if you put your system in Amazon or if you put your system in Azure, there's certain things that you'll get for that are huge benefits. But you still are responsible for certain aspects of the security of that system. And so you kind of have to learn new skills of how do I keep systems secure in AWS? How do I keep systems secure in Azure? And you have to learn a new set of skills, a new set of tools to do that. Yeah. But the potential is there to be much more secure in those environments. You have separate monitoring tools potentially to watch what's going on. AWS has a great security best practices guide. A long guide that walks through and says, you should do this, you should do this, don't do that. So go through the whole checklist and lock it down. You see all the time people who put their data on what they call an S3 bucket, that's right, storage, and they expose it to the internet on the state and don't lock it down. All the data is available to the world. So Amazon gives you the capability to be more secure than probably you could afford to do in your small organization, but it doesn't fall off the tree. It doesn't happen by accident. You've got to be ready to do the work to make it secure. All right. Thanks for your patience, you guys.
Thank you guys so much. And we're running pretty late, so I think there's snacks out there, but then I also think they're starting the final. Yeah, so thank you so much. You did a great job. It just boggles my mind how much there is to this. I would never be in security, especially in the hospital.
You gotta sign up for security?
There's not enough money.
Get to come work in security now?
Well, actually, so my boyfriend actually does cybersecurity and has his degree, which is the only reason I know anything about man in the middle and brute force.
Okay, yeah.
And that's it. Everything else is like. But he,